Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all for this webinar on behalf of me and the India International Center. We are very grateful to the IIC for hosting this webinar on this very important subject and a very topical subject. Now, let me go straight to the subject. The title is a kind of poser, a kind of question, that how robust is India's democracy? Now, we have a democracy. There's no doubt about it that India has been a democracy in structure and form for the past 7 decades is an irrefutable fact. We also claim it as the largest democracy in the world. In a recent address to global investors, Prime Minister Modi said that India is the best place to invest because it is a democracy. To showcase this, even at this extremely resource-starved times, the justification given to develop Delhi Central Vista at a cost of rupees 25,000 crore is to build an ultra-modern parliament house, which will be a temple for India's robust democracy. But just conducting regular election at regular intervals alone do not make democracy robust. There are several parameters. I will just list them, pose it to the speakers. I hope you will respond to this during your presentations, which will follow. First is the people. The political idea of democracy, as propounded by the founding fathers, all power and authority of the sovereign independent India, its constituent parts and organs of government are derived from the people. Democratic governance was to rise from the grassroots, village panchayat, jilla parishad, urban local government, state government and central government. Original constitution did not provide for grassroots democracy and it was grafted through the 73rd and 74th amendments in 1992. Has our democracy gained roots even after nearly 3 decades? Political parties play a larger than life role in India's democracy. They contest election, capture power, and rule the country. Do they have any legal rigor? How transparent are their functioning and fundraising? What is the process of selection of candidates? Are they public or private entities? As they claim, under the RPA Act, they were claiming that they were private entities. If it is the latter, what business they have in running governments and deciding people's life and fate? Do political parties have any principles, ideology or values? Defection of party cadres and entry of corrupt and criminal elements have become routine and lucrative business. Elections reek with corruption and state governments are formed with purchased MLAs. Is this robust democracy? Another very important point, how representative is India's democracy? We have this first-past-the-post system in which a party get even about 25% of the electorate's mandate can gain majority in parliament or assembly and rule the country by thrusting its agenda on 3/4 of the electorate. This is highly disproportional. Disproportional system has been talked about for the last several decades. This is a system wherein parties gain seats in proportion to the number of votes cast for them. This was advocated in 1977 itself, and I had a small part to play when Jayaprakash Narayan, immediately after the Janata Party's victory, 1977, set up a small committee, and I was also asked to assist the committee. And the three major recommendations we gave were proportional representation based on the German list system, right to reject and right to recall. Nothing seemed to have happened for these reforms in the last so many decades. Constitution Article 324 mandates the Election Commission of India to conduct fair and free elections with integrity and level playing field. Inclusive electoral rolls, free from criminal and money power, stringent and impartial implementation of model code of conduct, independent and neutral media, mainstream, social and digital. But is this happening? The voting system, we have this electronic voting system. Does the EVM VPAT voting, on which a lot of deliberations are going on across the country, voting, counting and declaration of results comply with basic democracy principles? This may be excellent electronic machines. But do they comply with democracy principles? These principles are the votes cast as intended, indicating that the voting machine has registered the vote correctly, recorded as cast, indicating that the cast vote is correctly included in the final tally, and counted as recorded, indicating that final tally is correctly computed. Are these possible at all with electronic voting? This is a matter of great discussion that is going on. Are parliaments, assemblies and their oversight committees are really functioning? Major legislations and policies agriculture, electricity, environment, education, public sector privatization, RTA Act, Citizens Amendment Act, are all pushed through the parliament without discussion. Even now, question hour is being disposed of, and which is the essential of a parliamentary system. They don't even question hour during this pandemic times. Democracy is sustained by institutions, not individuals. And we have excellent institutions of governance, both within the constitution and outside the constitution. How independent and autonomous are they, these democratic institutions of governance, including President of India, Parliament, and even a cabinet? How about the lesser ones like Minority Commission, Comptroller and Auditor General, Election Commission of India, and Reserve Bank of India? What about CBC, CBI, NIA, and ED? Where are the Lokpal and NHRC? We have not heard of these institutions at all, and what are they doing? Without them, can we have a real robust democracy? Federalism is basic structure of our democracy. Constitution says, India, that is Bharat, shall be the union of states. Center cannot exist without the states. Yet every legislation, policy practiced by the center is driving a nail in the coffin of federalism. How can such democracy be robust? India is supposed to be the world's largest democracy. How does it look from the international perspective in vibrancy and robustness? With massive concentration of wealth and a fast-growing oligarchy, amidst extreme inequity and impoverishment, is there real economic democracy in India? See, political democracy alone is not. Economic democracy equally, if not more important. That's what our founding father said. But then, do we really have elected democracy with about 60% of the people outside the mainstream of our economy? Then how are the four estates of democracy, legislature, executive, judiciary, and media functioning? Are they functioning independently to uphold democracy and make it vibrant and robust? And last but not the least, freedom and liberty are the core of democracy. Do our people enjoy unfettered freedom and democracy? Have they not been shrinking fast, particularly in the last few years? These precious gifts were the first to be cast aside and thrown out under the harshest pandemic lockdown imposed overnight. How then can our democracy be called robust? These are some of the important posers and questions I thought I'll place before the speakers. They can express their views. But there are many more. Democracy is a very vast subject, and robustness of that in the largest democracy in the country is of critical importance. So the webinar will be like this. The next about 30 minutes, three of the speakers will make their initial presentation. And we have three distinguished speakers today. One is an academician come activist. I will be introducing him just now. He will be the first to speak. We have a distinguished political leader belonging to the ruling party, Madam Lalitha Lalitha Kumara Mangalam, and Mr. distinguished diplomat, Mr. K.P. Fabian. First, I think I'll ask Professor Stoker. Let me introduce him before he starts. He is, because he's got a big introduction, I don't want to, we want to spend more time on conveying the message than introducing ourselves. First of all, he is an academician. He was the professor, dean, and director in charge of IIM Ahmedabad. Basically an engineer and a management graduate. And after that, he has been more active in the field of democracy. He is a founder of the famous Association for Democratic Reforms. And along with the Election Watch, they have done a yeoman service in promoting democracy and electoral integrity in the country. I will ask Mr. Professor Jagdeep Chokar to present his views for 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Devasayam. Mr. Devasayam has laid out a very, very broad kind of field out, and then he ended with the question, under these conditions, can India's democracy be called robust? And since he only asked the question and did not answer it, I will take this opportunity of answering the question. I do not think India's democracy is robust at all. This may sound not very heartening or not very optimistic to a lot of people, but I believe that is the case. And before I present a few facts in support of what I say, let me also do a little more difficult and provocative act by saying that India is a democracy is an assumption. I am not really sure we are indeed a democracy. And if we are a democracy, are we a procedural democracy or are we a substantive democracy? Now, to substantiate some of what I've just said, I would refer to a piece in the Hindu written by a very distinguished professor of history, Professor Harbans Mukhiya, as late as September the 2nd, just about 7 days ago. And he has made a few, he has made many points, but I will reiterate just a couple of them. One, he says the unprecedented concentration of wealth at the top 1% around the world knocks the bottom out of our competition in the market, which is so integral to its freedom. Then he says, other freedoms, other constituents of democracy, by hollowing out the substance of even free and fair elections and individual freedoms while retaining the form. This is what Mr. Devasayam partially referred to. Then he makes a very important observation, which says today, remarkably democratic and progressive constitutions around the world give rulers enough space for misuse for achieving those goals and yet making the misuse palatable to voters through media and mobilization. And then he says that if this concentration of wealth and political power was the case with one country or society, it could easily be attributed to specific local conditions. And this is most important, but this looks like a more generalized global scenario. In the US, China, Russia, India, Brazil, Hungary, Turkey, and elsewhere. And then he says, clearly, we are witnessing the transformation of democracy, a systematic transformation from within, from one that had brought us the promise of liberty, equality, fraternity, political and social and economic, to its very opposite, which he refers to as a new democracy. My submission, ladies and gentlemen, is that this so-called new democracy is not a democracy. It is something else. Mr. Devasayam just mentioned about elections. Let me say that while regular multi-party elections are an essential requirement of a democracy, it is certainly not sufficient. And particularly when the elections do not evoke complete confidence of the electorate. While one may argue on this issue, but let me state some facts which are incontrovertible. In the process of election watch that Mr. Devasayam referred, the organization I work with, the Association for Democratic Reforms, has been calculating the number of members of the Lok Sabha who have criminal cases pending against them according to self-sworn affidavits. The candidates under oath declare themselves that I have X, Y, Z number of criminal cases pending against me. So therefore, the numbers cannot be wrong because people are telling us this about themselves under oath. And the numbers that I want to share are that in the 2004 Lok Sabha, 24% of our so-called honorable members of the Lok Sabha had criminal cases pending against them. 24% in 2004. Then we came to 2009. The number of members of Lok Sabha who had criminal cases pending against them came up to 30% instead of 24% in 2004. We kept doing whatever we could, hoping that this number might go down. But in 2004, to our great surprise and chagrin, this number had gone up to 34%. Again, we thought we need to retool and redo things. But again, in 2019, this number rose to 43%. Now, this consistent rise from 24 to 30 to 35 to 43 over a 20-year period tells us unmistakably that the number of members of parliament of the Lok Sabha who have criminal cases pending against them is rising consistently. Now, does this indicate that our election process and our electoral process are working effectively, efficiently, the way they should? I am afraid I believe it is not the case. Then we come to Mr. Devasaya mentioned to representativeness. Now, sheer numbers, if there are 49 to 51%, and if the 51% make decisions for the 49% also, I believe that is a case of majoritarianism and not democracy. Therefore, in a appropriate, effective democracy, there are counteracting institutions, such as the presidency, the parliament, the state legislatures, the judiciary at the Supreme Court and the High Court level, the Comptroller and Auditor General, the CAG, the Election Commission, and last but not least, the political parties. Now, are these institutions functioning as checks and balances on the executive? We have all seen that the parliament is not functioning for the last 6 months in any case, but the parliament has actually not been functioning since 2012. I wrote a piece in the newspaper in 2012, which was titled Denigration of Parliament. The opposition party, then there was another party in opposition, today there is another party in the opposition. There have been recorded instances of the leader of the opposition announcing the evening before that tomorrow we will not allow the Lok Sabha to function. Now, this is actually a complete and deliberate subversion of democracy. So when our highest institution like the parliament are treated this way, I don't know what to expect. We have seen what is happening in the judiciary. We have seen what is happening with the CAG, with the election commission and so on. The last parties, this is what is the most disturbing. Political parties are the pillars of a representative democracy like we have in India. We have a vibrant democracy, as all of us say and believe. But when we look at the pillars of democracy, we find that they are not democratic at all. I dare say not a single political party functions in an internally democratic way. If the pillars are not democratic, how can we have a democracy at the top? And that is why I say that our democracy is hollow. We have a superstructure of democracy, which seems like a democracy, but the base or the roots of our democracy are absolutely hollow. We can go on to freedom of expression, freedom of association, rule of law, talking of transparency. The Indian Express of August 27, which about a couple of weeks ago had a headline, which said, "Do not reveal panel proceedings to media." This is what the chairman of the Rajya Sabha, the Honorable Vice President of the country, said. Now, obviously, I mean, all of us know that the proceedings of parliamentary committees are supposedly confidential. I don't understand why they should be so. But to deliberately prevent, for example, as Mr. Devasaya mentioned, there is going to be no question hour. I mean, we don't know what is happening in our country and in our neighborhood. What we see happening in China, which is revealed, something more is revealed every other day. If we then go on to some numbers, we find that something called the Global State of Democracy Index, the World Democracy Index, the Freedom of the World Report, India is now rated as a flawed democracy. And in some things, we are lower than a large number of countries which we think are more, much less developed than we are. So friends, in my opinion, Indian democracy, far from being robust, is in a very fragile and delicate state. We need to do everything possible. We, the people of this country, which is the people who gave ourselves this constitution, have to do whatever we can, not to make it stronger or robust. We have to restore democracy in the country, which is a very, very important job. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Jagdeep Chokha. Before I invite Lalita Kumaramangalam, a small announcement. You can start posting your questions now onwards. You can direct the question to a particular speaker, or it could be general. And we want this webinar to be more interactive. We would like to hear your views and respond to your views. We have half an hour for that purpose. So please feel free to ask whatever questions you want to ask, so that we can have an interactive session after the speakers complete their first round of presentations. Now I'll request Madam Lalita Kumaramangalam. She is from a distinguished family in Tamil Nadu, and she is an economics and management graduate. She has been in politics with Bharatiya Janata Party, and she has contested elections a couple of times. So now over to Lalita Kumaramangalam.
Good evening and namaskar, everybody. Let me take off from where my esteemed panelists who spoke before me, their opinions. Now, I'll also fill you in a little about my own background. I come from an extremely leftist, left-leaning, I would say leftist family. But I'm the only one who has, I entered politics pretty late in life. And I'm the only one who came straight into the Bharatiya Janata Party. There are many voices that are raised, especially amongst the intellectual, or what so-called intellectuals, as I say, because I think everybody basically has a certain amount of intellect, which cannot be denied. Especially amongst the English-speaking intellectuals who feel that the advent of the BJP coming, the Bharatiya Janata Party coming to power, has suppressed in many ways democracy. Our founding fathers, with all due respect to them, and with all their good senses and their good ambitions, their excellent ambitions for a country that was teetering on the precipice of both economic and political devastation, wrote up a constitution that has had more than 120 amendments made to it. Of course, any democracy is a growing, it's a living organism. It cannot live either only in the past or only in the present. We have to take what happened in our past history into consideration, apply it to what is happening today. When the first industrial revolution hit the world, there was a huge upheaval. As the IT revolution hit the world in the last century, in the last decade of the last the 2000s, there was again a huge upheaval. Today's democracy is not dependent only on our constitutional strength or our political, the strength of our and the resilience of our political process, but also on the economic and the economic state that we find ourselves in, which has to take into account the militarization of various countries in the world. India partially included. We are not anywhere near being the most heavily militarized. And I'm not saying this with either approval or disapproval. It's just a fact I'm putting before you. Also, the fact that economically, India still has a long way to go. Mr. Devasayam said one thing which I totally agree with, that liberty depends also on the amount of economic freedom any individual has in a country. Now, the political process in our country is certainly not totally transparent. I agree it could do with a lot more transparency from all sides. not just the politicians and the political parties and their ethoses, etc., but also the amount of investment that institutions that are both non-political and that are political have got vested in the process of elections itself. I agree that political funding is a problem, and it's a, I think it's a problem all over the world, not just in India. But I would personally like to see more transparency in the whole process of elections. I stood for elections, as Mr. Devsam said, more than once. And I have been appalled at the amount of money that changes hands during elections. This was in the state of Tamil Nadu, which is amongst the most, the top three, most top five most urbanized at the moment states in the country, and amongst, considered amongst the most developed states of the country, industrially with regard to education, health indices, etc. But there is one thing that India still enjoys. I think, and this is my personal opinion, not because I'm a member of any political party, but my personal opinion, I have from birth seen politics taking place. I had a grandfather who died as a governor, a father who died as a central cabinet minister, who was considered the right hand of Indira Gandhi at that time, a brother who was in two cabinets, both of Mr. Narasimha Rao and of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. So I have seen politics, you know, throughout my life. I have seen the changes. Sometimes many things, according to me, have remained the same. Perhaps the political ethos has changed, but the process of politics has often remained the change. Often, there are many people who do not agree with the sort of democracy that India is. Suggestions are always welcome, of course, but I think the basic power of India's democracy is that we all still have a voice. Yes, there are many times when people feel their voices are being stifled, but in India, we have the advantage, or perhaps the blessing in many ways, and this is not due to any single political party or any single politician, etc., that we still have recourse to criticism. However bitter it may be, we are able to criticize. Now, whether people listen or not, again, I suppose in a democracy, one can say that it's up to me whether I want to listen to you or not, and vice versa. But I agree that ours is still not a fully mature democracy due to many of the factors, due to the, according to me personally as a social activist, because despite my education and family background, I have worked with marginalized women and marginalized communities, including sex workers, truckers, the LGBT community, the transgender community, etc., for the last 30 years. So according to me, what a greater democracy India should invest in and needs definitely is far greater levels of education, awareness, and access. Access to health, access to good nutrition and food, because nutrition and food really does compromise the mental growth of any child anywhere in the world. And also access to not just roads and dams and electricity and pipe gas and water. Those are equally important. But access to good sanitation, access to good food and nutrition, access to education. These are amongst the most important factors that will perhaps help us to build and build on whatever democracy we have now. I don't think it's fair to compare whether we were more democratic in the 1950s or the 1970s or the 1990s or now. Each regime had their share of ups and downs. It's fair enough. We are a democracy. Criticism must be, should be there and must be accepted. In terms of the broadening of education, I find that politics often, well, it minimizes the camera that, you know, one can look through for somebody who is accessing education, one can look through. In terms of, say, language, in terms of regional disparities, in terms of many economic disparities. Unfortunately, there is a huge amount of divisiveness in terms of caste, creed, and language, especially of lately, and especially from my own state of Tamil Nadu. But these are things that one must learn. I wouldn't say we should accept it. We should never accept it. But
what happened? Oh, what do we do now?
I'm sorry, I just got cut off, I think, for half a minute. So as I was saying, in a healthy democracy, interaction, for example, between me and the three very senior gentlemen who are on the panel with me, this is what is perhaps the best proof of a vibrant and a living democracy. We are, I mean, none of us would ever be happy with everything that's happening in the country at a particular point of time. But the fact that we have the right to criticize, that we have the right to bring it up and publicly criticize, this is what is the most important. The fact that our voices are still heard by many, many people across the country, this is what I think still has hope for any democracy in the world. Now, nobody can 100% agree with the people who are governing the country or even governing a state for that matter. There will always be differences. India has hundreds of political parties. You can't expect them all to be on the same board all at the same time. It just is impossible. It's also impractical. But the fact that perhaps it does gall many people that the Bharatiya Janata Party has a huge majority in the Lok Sabha. It is an absolute majority. And probably pretty soon we are heading for absolute majority in the Rajya Sabha in a couple of years' time. Now, of course, for those who do not agree with our ethos and our way of politics, will find it very galling and will think that democracy is not thriving in this country. But personally speaking, one of the biggest proofs is that how often I sit on such panels, I sit on such, not just on the TV, but off it on so many, seminars, etc. When I talk to students, when I talk to my own, the people whom I work with, women and other marginalized communities, I reply to questions which are very critical. And this is so of everybody, from every party, it should be, I think, and it probably is, though I can't, say something on behalf of other political parties. The fact that we are actually questionable and that we do answer is one of the most strongest points for any democracy. The press in India, I agree, there are, again, nobody can have the same view about the press. I am equally critical of much of how the press deals with issues, especially the current television and media that I think is going overboard on one particular subject. But I can also be equally, and this is nothing to do with whether they are pro-right or pro-left or pro-center or anything of the sort. I have met with the stalwarts of the press, including Ramnath Goenka, in those days when I was a young child and I had gone to with my father. And the most important thing that I think is that our press is still free. We have a lot of press that's very critical of the government, as it has every right to be. And I mean, it's not as a criticism. Like I say, in democracy, criticism is what keeps us alive, keeps us vibrant, keeps us moving along, keeps the whole idea that it is everybody has a right to their opinion and everybody has a right to voice their opinion and to see if they can ensure that their opinion is also heard, both the highest of the political and governance echelons, and that it resonates at the grassroots also. When we talk about panchayats, I'd like to say one thing. The fact that reservation for women today has brought out about 13.5 lakh women at the panchayat level, and over 40% of these women are today. It has taken 25 years, but we've got there. The over 25% of these women are not naam ke vaaste, that is, they are not there just in name only. These are women who have understood the panchayat process, who have understood the power that being a panchayat member or a panchayat president gives them, and people, women who actually have learned, even if they may not all be as literate as I am or the other panelists are. They are not intellectuals in that sense of the word, but they have intellect enough to be able to govern on their own. And that is true democracy. Perhaps we need more concentration on our panchayats. This I sincerely feel, again, regardless of which party may be in power or which state we are talking about, we need to have much more reforms with regard to the decisions that Panchayati Raj, people who are participating in the Panchayat Raj, that is at the village level, can actually make on their own with regard to their daily lives, with regard to whatever investment they feel they need to make. their access to markets in both within their own where they live and access to far off markets. But where India has faltered really is, I feel, in the last 70 years, economically we have not yet, and I don't want to use the word liberalized, but we have not yet democratized enough, because there are still too many millions of people who live below the poverty line, though many of them have been brought out of the in the last 15 years. And I think I've probably run out of time. So I'll end by saying that what I look forward to is to see that every single person in this country, every child has access to education and good health and nutrition. Every young adult has the right, has access to skilling and the right to dream and to be able to, you know, build their own life on the basis of their own abilities. And that everybody has the right to voice their opinions about how the country is being governed and to participate in it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Janita Maramangalam. Incidentally, she is the daughter of the famous Mohan Kumaramangalam, one of the outstanding advocates that we had in the country, and also a leftist leader. I have met him personally, and she is the sister of Rangarajan Kumaramangalam, who unfortunately passed away when he was a cabinet minister. Now, we'll move on to Ambassador Fabian. He is a distinguished diplomat. He has got several qualifications. I don't want to go into all. He was former ambassador to Italy. He's been a visiting professor of JNU. And presently, he is a professor at the Indian Society of International Law. I would request him to respond to what others spoke and also his views. In addition, if you can mention something about the international and from the international perspective of India's democracy, it would be good. Ambassador Fabian.
Thank you, Deva. Thank you for that cordial introduction, but you did not mention that we are batchmates. 1964.
Thank you.
Well, fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen, good evening to all of you. Let me just make two comments on, you know, I've been listening with the rapt attention to the previous speakers. I agree entirely or almost entirely with what they said. India's democracy can be more robust. It is not robust enough. And Ms. Lalitha Kumaramangalam said, you know, it's a growing democracy. Yeah, it's growing, but is the growth there or is it stunted? She also, and you also, Chair, mentioned about economic freedom. Yes, economic freedom is important, but economic freedom for whom? You know, among the countries that have the largest number of billionaires, India comes among the top three. China is the first, second is United States, and the third is India. And the number of billionaires in India is growing fast. So there is economic freedom in India. Ms. Kumaramangalam mentioned about money spent during the election. Very important point. What about the money being spent after the election? The chair wanted me to look at, you know, India's democracy from an international point of view. Well, I have been in many countries, but in no country have I seen legislators being taken away to resort hotels without their cell phones and kept there. I have never seen. This is an Indian speciality. Okay, now let us sort of look at this question in a non-partisan way. The idea is not to praise or dispraise anyone in particular. Now, let's take a theoretical approach. And that reminds me of Montesquieu, the French philosopher, 18th century. He propounded the doctrine of the separation of powers. The state power is held, there are three holders, the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. Now, there can be three types of relationship among them. One, all of them respect the boundaries and they work cooperatively for the common good. That is the best state of affairs. Second is one encroaches on the other and that encroachment is not resisted. That's not good. Third is surrender on the part of one of the three, even without any pressure, that is anticipating the wishes of the other. That's also not good. Now, Professor Choker said about the parliament meeting, as he pointed out, no questions from members, no 0 hour. Incidentally, 0 hour is an innovation of the Indian parliament and no private members bill. Now, dear friends, let me ask you, what's the point of a parliament meeting where the members of parliament elected by us, we the people, the first two words of our constitution, when they cannot ask questions to the government? The business of the parliament is to keep an eye on the government, meaning the executive, and to pass legislation. So, what are we coming to? Why can't there be question hour? I have not seen any good reason given. Okay, so that is what where we are. And now let me sort of move to the judiciary. In early 1960s, there was a famous case, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia versus the state of Bihar. And it was a question of habeas corpus. And the Supreme Court ruled in favor of Dr. Lohia, and the district magistrate's order detaining him was declared null and void. Now, more recently, in Jammu and Kashmir, there have been many cases of habeas corpus before the High Court of Jammu and Kashmir, and the High Court has been sitting upon them. You see, habeas corpus is to be decided with a certain promptness, urgency. And then the matter was taken up with the Supreme Court and there was no relief. Now, my question is it that the judiciary anticipated the wishes of the executive? You decide. Now, I have been to many countries, but I've never come across a judiciary which is so obsessed with its court dignity, unquote, and court contempt, unquote, quote unquote, real or imaginary. The judiciary does its work and its work speaks for itself. If anyone tweets, it doesn't make any difference. But here, we have spent so much of our time, so much of our energy on a contempt case and the fine is 1 rupee. Well, there hangs a tale. But you know the tale. I don't have to expand on it. Now, Montesquieu did not mention the media. Well, the media should be the watchdog and not the lapdog. Well, in the ISE on the 12th, we have a webinar on that. You should all attend to that. Now, I want to go back to economic freedom for a second. In the year 2018, more than 8 lakhs of children died, children under the age of 5 in India. That was the highest for any country. So, what does it mean? Is there any economic freedom for them? Now, democracy implies good governance. And I want to make a point about COVID-19, which is the reason why we are meeting in this fashion. The first cases were detected in the state of Kerala end of January. And by the time the first case was detected, the state government had already constituted a high power 18-member committee the state health minister Shailaja, she took the initiative. Now my question is, was there a conversation between the Minister of Health of the state of Kerala and the Union Health Minister? If not, why not? Secondly, naturally the Union Home Minister would have read the media and that there were cases in Kerala and that those cases came from China. Question, when did India ban the flights from China? Another question, we should have taken action in February. Then we were all so busy unrolling the red carpet for President Trump. Incidentally, his health secretary could not talk to him about the danger of COVID-19 in the United States because Trump was too busy with other things. When he called, he asked him about, oh, what about the electronic cigarette? Have you cleared it? So that was the case. Now coming to the question of the lockdown. Well, I think we have now seen that the lockdown did not have the intended impact. A senior member of Niti Aayog said, you know, by May 26th, there will be no fresh cases. Now we know where we are. My last point, and I'm concluding. Before taking such a measure as a lockdown for the whole of India, there should have been a cabinet paper prepared. That paper would have given the pros and cons. It would have listed the actions to be taken, including the action to be taken about the millions of migrant labor and the actions to be taken after the announcement. Nothing was done. Is this democracy? Taking an action of such major importance without due preparation? So, I think we all should agree that India's democracy can be better. And it's our job as voters. That means we have to vote intelligently. Well, we have done it at times, but we have not done it always. Intelligently means you should look at the candidate, the candidate's background, and then vote. And there are many more points to be made, especially with institutions, but as the chair himself has mentioned, you know, about VVPATs and all that, I won't get into it, but thank you so much for listening to me.
Thank you, Ambassador Fabian. All the three speakers kept to the time absolutely short. So we have enough time for question and answers and interaction. We have quite a few questions. Before going to that, I would like to make one observation. See how fragile India's democracy was exhibited on the night of 24th March 2020. I've been closely observing the pandemic, how it developed. I don't want to go into the past. But what happened was, I've been writing on this. I've written several articles on this. I have to do a lot of research. So what actually happened was, on the 22nd of March, the bureaucracy, the top bureaucracy in the country, principal secretary to the prime minister, the cabinet secretary, all in consultation with the chief secretaries, had decided to declare a lockdown for 75 districts in the country. Just 75 out of 730. Because these districts had cases of coronavirus. About 500 odd cases, about 10 to 15 deaths. And then they decided, all right, this here, the lockdown, and they issued instructions. It was in the media also on 23rd. And they also gave absolute distinct flexibility to the states to increase or decrease. The only one decision they took was interstate transportation will be prevented. Stop. That was within the authority of the government of India. That was on the 22nd. It came in all the papers. The list of 75 districts came. That was the correct way of handling it. Cocooning is the word that is used. Cocooning. The elderly people, the vulnerable people, and the young people will move. Youngsters will move with the kind of precautions. 75 districts to be up and down depending upon the district and state administration. God alone knows. That was based on the recommendation of the experts. God alone knows what happened. On 24th night at 8 p.m., Prime Minister comes in and says, lockdown for the entire country, starting from 12 o'clock onwards. I don't want to go into detail. You know what happened. Next day morning, policemen were on the streets, beating up everybody who were walking, buying milk or taking a walk in the morning, beating up. Democracy, freedom, liberty completely collapsed. That's what I'm saying. You are talking about robustness. Every one of us has experienced it. And we have seen the inhuman way the migrant workers were treated and all those things happened. Now that single act has led to a colossal fall of the economy. As it is, economy was not doing well. But anyway, this kind of, because I'm a student of economics, we know ups and downs, trade cycle do take place. But this single act immediately choked off all activities and small business died, almost every economic activity died. And now people are losing their jobs in crores. I really do not know, will we ever be able to recover this economy? So very clearly, the way, if it had been handled in a democratic manner, this just about 5 months ago, and then liberty and freedom was the first casualty to go. Now, if our democracy had been vibrant, we would have done all this within the confines of our democracy. People should have been educated. At least a couple of days, nobody knew. When the lockdown was imposed, nobody knew what was corona, how it is coming, how am I involved, how it is going to be affected. Nobody knew. People should have been educated. And police was the last to be asked to implement. The social sector should have been asked to implement. The medical department should have been asked to implement. Police to only support them. Because we did not think about democracy. We just thought we can impose a totalitarian system and control it. That is why we have failed in controlling coronavirus and we have failed in maintaining, retaining our economy. This is a very serious matter. Now let us go to the questions. There are questions specifically addressed to the speakers. Let me go to them. The first question is Ambassador Fabian. Question. Shall I read out these questions and then you can take? How do we do that? For each one or?
No, you will have to. We are not getting it. So you, I can't read them because they are not coming to me.
Shall I read out the questions and all the questions? Then you will take the response or one by one. Anyway, let me read out the questions. Greetings to Ambassador Fabian. The powers can only work if boundaries are respected. Do you think the judiciary, anticipating the wishes of the executive, can be prevented by discharging the system of appointment? That is question for Ambassador Fabian.
No, I didn't get the question. What? Please repeat.
Say separation of powers can only work if boundaries are respected. Do you think the judiciary, anticipating the wishes of the executive, can be prevented by changing the system of appointment? I'll read out all the questions, only 10-15 of them. Please note down your own questions and you can respond. Otherwise, it will take more time. Then second question from that was from Balveer Arora. Your question to Ambassador Fabian. Dr. Saroj Kumar Prakash of Delhi. Dalita ji, how often voices are heard? They are offered, they are suppressed. Are you satisfied with the health status? I am not. I am a doctor. That is to Madam Kumara Mangalam. Then Prem Verma from Ranchi. Sedition and UPA acts have no place in democratic country. How come it exists in India? Today we live in a fear of being arrested and imprisoned without trial. If we voice dissent, is that democracy? This is a very serious
question. Mr. Delsan, can you just repeat the question that was asked of me?
How often voices are heard? They are suppressed. Are you satisfied with the health status in the country? That is the question for you. One. After that, Prem Verma's question is about sedition and the UAPA Act. That I can respond. No problem. To Professor Jagdeep Chokha, funding of election is an issue which lies at the root of much of the corruption which we see today. The problem is that only people who can change the present that is so all its biggest beneficiaries. What, in your opinion, can be done to change this? This is Vinay Sanghi from Gurgaon. Then Ms. Kumara Mangalam, if we do answer as you said, then why is question ever removed? Next question is from S.N. Ghosh, Shimla. Has discourse of democracy has changed in the recent past? How far institutional erosion contributed to this for Professor Chokar? Is the so-called majoritarian nationalism threat to our plural and secular society? Then Dr. V.N. Sharma from Ranchi again. Democracy is totally at the mercy of the majority party and its leader in parliament, as he can always be bypass the laws, the rules, the norms, the guidelines, and the established conventions. So much so that Indian democracy looks like a farce. Now even courts and judges acts are questionable. Therefore, Indian democracy stands in a weak, very weak ground. My question is, how can that be changed into a real, true democracy in all senses? Then, this is just an observation about Mrs. Kumara Mangalam. Mrs. Kumara Mangalam is more as a leftist than a rightist. She is the right person in the wrong party. Anyway, question for Mrs. Kumara Mangalam. You said that the country was teetering on the precipice of economic and political disaster when the Constitution
was framed. No, I didn't say that.
No, when the Constitution was framed. Is the situation any different now? Okay, then Saurabh Kumar, Bangalore. The infirmities in the pillars of democracy, political parties mentioned by Professor Chokar. What single reform can enable greater, easier individual representation, short of party democracy, that might be impractical? That might be an effective check on wayward party functioning centered on vested interests. Subhash Kumar from, then Balveer Arora again. Question for Professor Chokar. What sort of protection can we think for independent institutions like Election Commission, ED, CBI, etc.? Then the other questions are, Rajesh Kumar Yadav from Jharkhand. If democracy is safe, is in safe hands, has democracy been safe in safe hands since independence? The next question is, very blunt question from Saroj Kumar Prakash Devi. Is there anything democratic at all? Then from Father Sunny Jacob, what happens to our vibrant democracy when parliament itself stops working, when the government failing to provide leadership to the people in this time of crisis, like the pandemic? How can democracy be strengthened? These are the questions that have come so far. I think you can take it up according to your convenience. We can start with, I think, Professor Chokar. On to the question that is
being okay. The first question that I noticed for myself was from somebody called Vinay Sanghi on funding of elections. This is actually one of the most fundamental issues that challenges democratic functioning anywhere and everywhere. Money is certainly needed for running and maintaining and functioning of political parties and for contesting elections. Nobody denies that. But the only issue is, how does that money come in and how it is spent? Today in India, it is a black box, and it has been a black box for 70 odd years. The problem is that the blackness of that box is becoming more and more intense as we go forward. We had one government which introduced electoral trusts, and the organization I worked with, Association for Democratic Reforms, actually discovered that both the leading parties, BJP and the Congress, were guilty, as decided by the Delhi High Court, of violating the FCRA, Foreign Currency Regulation Act, under the garb of electoral trusts. Then the current government introduced, under the label of increasing electoral transparency or funding transparency, it introduced what it called electoral bonds. And the story of electoral bonds is a saga which I cannot repeat here because it will take away all the time. They have made the opaqueness of the financing of the electoral processes completely and absolutely opaque. So the only answer to that question, Mr. Sanghi, is that until there is complete transparency of how much money does a political party get, where does it get it from, how does it get it, and where does it spend this money, how does it spend, and how much does it spend. Unless this complete this, I am afraid we will not be able to deal with the problem of, or I would say the malady of the impact of money on elections. And as I read the somebody from Professor Arbanz Mukhiya, when 1% of a country control 90% of its wealth, and out of that 1%, maybe 2 or 3, 4 or 10 people control all the money that political parties get, we can see what can happen, and we are seeing what is happening. So that is the answer to that. Mr. Ghosh asked me about majoritarianism and institutional decay, if I recollect right. Institutions have decayed over time. Institutions do not decay all at once. And the decay in the institutions started long time ago. In between, it came to be checked somewhat. Institutions sort of not retaliated, they reasserted themselves and things were getting better. But we are now again in a situation where institutions are completely, I think, out of what they should be. Majoritarianism is actually a big issue. Yes, there is a particular political formation, the NDA has absolute majority, the BJP also has an absolute majority, but the BJP polled only 37% of the votes cast, and the NDA polled about 40% of the votes cast. Now, this is a structural feature of our first past the post-electoral system. Whether we move to a proportional representation system or a combination of the first past the post and proportional representation, or which form of proportional representation, or we make corrections to the first past the post system, these are all absolutely in the realm of possibility. The Election Commission, the Law Commission of India gave its recommendations way back in 1999. But the entire political establishment, and let me repeat, the entire political establishment is not interested in changing the electoral system because they are bad people, they are like us, but they are familiar with the existing system and they know how to play the game under the current rules. They don't want to change the rules of the game because they don't know what would happen. So majoritarianism is not going to go away unless we do something about it. And I don't see any will to do that. Somebody asked what would be a single reform that would correct or perhaps improve the system significantly. I have no doubt. The single most important reform is bringing internal democracy to the functioning of political parties by law. And this expression by law is not mine. This is from the 170th report of the Law Commission of India submitted to the Law Ministry in 1999, in May of 1999, which has till today not been presented to Parliament. Justice Jeevan Reddy, B.P. Jeevan Reddy, was the chairman of that commission. If we could make political parties democratic in their internal functioning by law, then I think a large number of the maladies of our electoral and political system would be significantly corrected. Lastly, Professor Balbir Rao said that what protection can EEC, etc. Well, the only thing we can do is to change the system of their appointment. Today, the CEC, Chief Election Commissioner, and the Election Commissioners are appointed purely and exclusively by the government of the day. obviously, you know, technically they are appointed by the president at the recommendation of the cabinet and so on. But if we could make their appointment process more inclusive, which we ironically have done for the, you know, director, CBI, the central chief information commissioner, etc. But we have not been able to do that, or we don't want to do that for these central election commissioners. And unless we do that, I think they will not be protected. And of course, there is a little thing in the service conditions. The chief election commissioner enjoys a constitutional protection just like a Supreme Court judge, which means that a chief election commissioner cannot be removed from office unless there is an impeachment process as like a Supreme Court judge. Whereas constitutionally, the election commissioners are removable with a recommendation from the chief election commissioner. Of course, there are nuances here. There have been instances in the last few years where a chief election commissioner recommended the removal of an election commissioner, but that got embroiled in a legal case and it did not happen. So those are some of the things that I think were addressed to me. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Now, next will be Ambassador Fabian. But before that, there are 2-3 provocative questions for Madam Lalitha Kumaramangalam. I'll read that out so that he can prepare when he is responding. One is from Thomas Franco, Chennai. Does this government really enjoy the majority of the people? Then Kamala Menon from Delhi. What will be the definition of a secular state? Then third question is, what is happening in J&K is what kind of democracy according to you? What happened to Ashok Lavasa after he dissented? Is it also democracy? These are the three questions that have come for you. So that, but in the meantime, Ambassador Fabian can respond to the question.
Thank you, Chair. I should thank my fellow panelists because they are taking on the full burden of the questions. I'm getting away very lightly. I'm so glad about it. Now, I just want to make one comment before I come to the specific question. Professor Chokar mentioned about, you know, transparency or in the question of funding of political parties and all that. Well, one solution will be make them auditable by the CAG. Controller and Auditor General of India should audit the accounts of the political parties. I leave it at that. Now, coming to the question raised by Professor Dr. Belvir Arora, I think we last met, we first met in Venice and then we met in Delhi. The question was whether the judiciary can be, will have more independence if the appointment to the judiciary, the system is changed. Well, it's a complex question. All that I would say is that the government tried to change it, as we know, but it didn't work as they wanted it. And even now, even when the collegium recommends names, the government can sit on it and make things difficult. And in one case, the Attorney General, Gopal Subramaniam, well, he himself sort of, said he didn't want it because the government was sitting on it for too long. So I think the situation is that the government has too much of a say in the appointment of judges, and that has to be corrected. But then the question arises, does it mean that it should be left entirely to the judges? Well, that is something to be debated. But that the government has too much of say, and that is affecting the independence of the judiciary, is a fact. Thank you.
Paramangalam. Before that, just a minute, a couple of questions which I would like to respond. So people who have raised the questions are a bit worried. I will respond to questions like direct democracy and smaller states. Yes. Please unmute her.
Yeah, what did you say, sir, Mr. Devan? I thought the first question was, am I satisfied with the health status of the country and how often our voice is heard? Shall I start with that?
Yeah, I've given you all the questions.
Right, yes, yes. Okay, to the lady who asked the first question, how often voices are heard? Well, quite frankly, I think they are heard as often nowadays as they were in the past. As somebody pointed out, I come from a leftist background. So there were the same criticisms that were made of that government as are being made now. And believe me, I've really heard all of them. So if one feels that more voices should be heard, certainly there is no bar on that. And if anybody feels that their voice should be heard, they have the absolute democratic right to make sure that their voices are heard. Insofar as am I satisfied with the health status of citizens in this country? No, I'm not. Certainly not. And I feel that health needs to, the total amount of the GDP that is spent on health is only some 3-odd%. I think it needs to go up to at least 6 to 10%, which may take a while, but we are slowly getting there. And even now, I think the increase is about 3.6% of GDP, which is far too little for a country our size, and given the way our population is exploding also. So health status needs to, we need to take panchayats in this, I feel very strongly. We need to take panchayats on board if our health status is really is to improve. Secondly, I think Mr. Thomas Franco said, does the NDA or the BJP enjoy real majority? Well, as per the current parliamentary system of election, in parliament, we do enjoy a majority. Whether you say it is moral, immoral, ethical, unethical, all those are different questions. As was pointed out by my senior colleague on this senior speaker panelist on this webinar today, the current system of politics, if you want it to change, then the country has the people of this country have the power. They may not yet have the knowledge, but sooner or later people will vote those out whom they don't want. Now whether we approve of those who may be voted on or not is a personal decision and a personal view, and everybody has a right to that view. So as of now, yes, the BJP and the NDA, we do enjoy parliamentary majority in parliament, in not all the states, but in parliament. To Madam Kamala, who says the definition of a secular state, well, according to me, a secular state means the state and religions are totally separate. But unfortunately, that is not there anywhere in the world today. So, secularism itself is a very, very divided and very, very detailed and very complex debate. So I don't think we have the time for even me to go into it. But if you ask me, I come from a family that is so mixed that there is no question of caste or religion being even taken into account. But perhaps that is the best definition of a secular state, where everybody is equal. Nobody has any special rights. And everybody's way of life is given equal importance to. I don't think it's there anywhere in the world today, unfortunately. Mr. Ashok, somebody asked me about Jammu and Kashmir, is democracy there? I presume they meant post-abrogation of Article 370. You know, I have worked with many, many people across Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh. They're three very different states with very different needs, with very different populations, with very different indigenous populations also. And currently what we have seen is, yes, there is a degree of disenchantment, disconnect between the common people of Kashmir, of the valley, that is too beyond, I mean, up to one, the Peer Mountains, as they call it, Peer Punjal, as they call it. And, but in Jammu, people had always felt that they were not given equal representation because there was a vast difference between some constituencies had 25,000 people, some had 1.5 lakh people per seat. Now, all of that I think now there is in Jammu, the process of delimitation of constituencies is going on, which means that everyone's vote will count, will be roughly the same. There will be small differences as there always are, but throughout as it is across the rest of the country too, where perhaps you may have a few thousand more, a few thousand less in number of voters in each constituency, but generally they will be around the same. The people of Ladakh, as of now, there is they have always felt that they did not get their due, and it was really the valley that got most of the attention and had most of the power in the earlier system. But they also are looking forward to, I think, their own democratic processes moving forward. The hill councils there are in negotiation, as far as I know. I'm not an expert in it, so I cannot speak in too much detail here, to be honest. They are in negotiations, and there is a process that is in play, that is going on. Unfortunately, when this was announced, immediately after that, winter set in, and in winter in those places it's very difficult for any real governance in terms of reaching out to the people to go take place. Post that, the epidemic came in, and almost everything, as you know, has been stalled. Now the process is picking up again, and many more voices are being heard. I think the government has been given instructions that they need to now start working and reaching out to the people in all the three union territories there. Two union territories there, because the voices of the people there are need to be taken on board in order to ensure that equitable and a fair sense of democratic governance is brought back into not only the valley but also into Jammu and Ladakh. Ladakh's problem, remember, it is that it's probably the only union territory or the only part of India that has a border with all three countries, Pakistan, China, and Nepal. Theirs is a very peculiar problem in many ways, but again, that's a very detailed and long thing if I go into it. Each of the states have their own problems, and they will have to be looked at individually, especially in the present situation. And hopefully it will be an equitable thing, because I think each of them is now, each union territory is now being looked at as an individual entity, not just as one part of a big whole. So if there's anything else, with regard to Ashok Lavasa, I really don't want to comment, because it's an extremely political issue, and politics is very divided in this country. And it's a very long argument it will become. So I don't think I even have the time to go into that right now.
Thanks a lot, Ms. Kumar Mangalam. I will just respond to two questions. Both are very important. One is about how will roots of democracy deepen if you go in for small states? Certainly, yes. See, we have now 135, 136 crore people, and the imbalance. We have a country, we have a state with about 20 crore population, and we have states. Uttar Pradesh with about 20 crore population, and we have state with a few lakh population in the northeast. And the whole thing is in a chaotic kind of structure that we have. This is a major reorganization. I don't know. This is a very vast subject, which we can talk about for hours. But the fact remains, the answer is yes. Smaller states are certainly better administrative units, better political units, and we can have a better involvement of the people, and there could be a better democracy. Second question.
I agree with you there, sir, that smaller states mean better governance and better outreach to the people. There, I am 100% in agreement with you. We need much smaller states across the board. Yeah. I mean, across the eastern and the we call the Indo-Gangetic belt. We need much smaller states.
This is an important subject, I think, which calls for more detailed discussions. Second is another very important question about direct democracy. See, direct democracy has got three elements. One is referendum, right to recall, and initiating bills, citizens initiating bills on their own. We don't have direct democracy. Unfortunately, even the indirect democracy is not functioning well. How are you going to bring in direct democracy? But on matters of extremely critical importance, which concerns as we have discussed earlier, we have a faulty first-past-the-post system where 25-30% voters can bring a government in and they will rule the whole country, and people who have not voted for the particular party don't know where to go. So on important matters, for instance, in 1991, when the Congress brought in the massive economic reforms, LPG, they had no mandate. They should have gone for referendum, but we don't have the referendum system. Similarly, now when the Citizens Amendment Act was brought in, they have no referendum. Referendum means more than 50%. Unless a political party is in power with more than 50% of the votes, they should not take up major issues like amendment of the constitution, like amendment of the bringing in major policy, like they are bringing environmental policy, education policy, electricity policy, selling off the public sector. All these are very major issues which has impact on every citizen of this country. I think referendum is a must. Second was right to recall. See, even a political leader, whatever he may be, corrupt, whatever criminal, you have no right to recall. So there is a good case for direct democracy and citizen moved bills. We don't have even for a system of private members moving a bill. How do you talk about citizens moving a bill? So all these are major flaws in our democracy. That's why we have already concluded India is not a robust democracy. I think Professor Choker wants to intervene on this briefly, because we have to now wind up.
No, I don't want to intervene on the democratic thing, but I do want to comment on the issue that was raised by one of the audience members on Mr. Ashok Lavasa, the election commissioner, who recently resigned and became a vice president in the Asian Development Bank. It was, Ms. Lalita Kumara Mangalam said, it is a very complex and very political issue. And I think that is the reason it needs to be commented on, because it is a political issue. The question is, why should the functioning of the election commission be a political issue? The election commission is supposedly a neutral empire in the political contest. And if one election commission dissents, then first his dissent not being recorded in the minutes, then by some strange mysterious reason, his family being subjected to detailed scrutiny by various government institutions. I obviously don't know the facts, and I think nobody other than Mr. Lavasa and some people in the government may know the facts. But based on what has been reported in the media, there seems to be enough circumstantial evidence that all was not right in that system. And that has certainly left a very bad order about the functioning of the election commission and the politics in the country. I repeat myself when I say, why should the functioning of the election commission be a political issue? This is very sad. That's all I want to say.
Very good question, very good response. I think we'll have the final round. Now, whatever you want to say, let us do it in the final round. We have another few minutes left. I think before that, I'll just say Ashok Lavasa is a good friend of mine, my junior colleague, one of the finest officers I've known for about 30 years or so. But the question is, the circumstances under which he was eased out and the way he was eased out does not augur well for India's democracy at all. The election commission has to be an extremely independent institution, one of the most critical institution in the constitution, who are responsible for our democratic elections. I think this is not the way it should be handled. I don't want to go any further on that, because now I would request these speakers to spend 2 to 3 minutes to give their concluding remarks. This time we will go the reverse order. First will be Ambassador Fabian, then Madam Lalita Kumaramangalam, and finally Professor Choker. Ambassador Fabian, concluding remarks.
Thank you, Chair. I will take less time than you are giving me. We have been talking about reforms, but you know, quite often we forget to perform. That is, we do not comply with the law as it is, and then we want a reform of the law. So let's think about that. Second is that in the United States and elsewhere in the West, the candidates, they come to a common platform and there is a debate. We know that there is going to be a presidential debate in the United States. Now, we don't elect a president. We elect members of parliament. So let there be a debate between the different candidates, a debate which will be sort of moderated by a person not belonging to any party, and such a way that the candidate can explain what his or her plans are, and questions can be asked. So let's hope that sort of debate will take place. But how do we make sure of that? I suppose we as citizens have to raise our voice and tell the political parties that to have it. And the media also can play a role in this. Thank you.
Ms. Maramangala. Ms. Lalita Kumaramangalam. What happened? What happened? Professor Chokar, then go ahead.
A couple of points. I would reiterate that our democracy is not robust. Our democracy is very fragile. But as Mr. Churchill had apparently said, that that democracy is the most ineffective form of government, but a better one has yet to be discovered. And that the answer to the bad effects of democracy is more democracy. We need to make our democracy more effective. Obviously, if you look at all the countries on India's borders, Indian democracy stands heads and shoulders above. And if you compare Indian democracy with the democracies in all the countries that got freedom from colonial rule in the 1940s and 50s, I think India has done extremely well. And the third factor that I give in support of the fact that India has a functioning democracy is that organized people like me and Mr. Deva Saheb, etc., continue to do what we do, and we can continue to do that. So our democracy is functioning, but it is certainly not robust. It is far from robust. And actually, the biggest problem that I see in this democracy is the role of political parties. Political parties, and as I said in my major presentation also, all political parties are not democratic. It is amazing that we have undemocratic pillars trying to support a democracy. And this is, the thing that I find extremely, extremely almost unbelievable. So far as the question of freedom of expression is concerned, somebody had mentioned this to the gentleman who was in Uganda, Idi Amin. And there was some talk of freedom of speech. And Idi Amin said that in my country there is freedom of speech, but freedom after speech is another matter. So we are all pretty close to that situation, that there is freedom of speech certainly, but freedom after speech is a matter of concern. The number of people that have been called in by the National Investigation Agency and so on and so forth, freedom of speech is at risk. And therefore, internal democracy, financial transparency, and real freedom of speech are some things that we, the people, have to work for. Mr. Fabian said that media can play, completely agree, it can play a role. But media's role today is extremely dubious. I mean, as somebody said, that if somebody were to study Indian media 100 years from now, they will not know that the economy, the GDP has gone down by 23.9%. The Chinese are on our borders. There is a fairly strong degree of unemployment. They will feel that some actor had committed suicide and that was the only thing happening in the country. This is a very, very eloquent testimony on the state of the media. And our media, as a matter of fact, I keep saying that the business of journalism
and
the profession of journalism. Thank you.
Lalita Kumar Mangalam, briefly.
Can you hear me? Because I can't see you all. I can hear you, but can you hear me? Okay, fine. So then I'll just make my comments. See, I feel that democracy in this country is still thriving. One of the problems is that there has been a shift in the political ideology of the maxima of the major, not majoritarian shift, but a shift in the political ideology that was the most prominent in the last 50 to 60 years. And obviously, the shift has created many ripples of both dissent and dissatisfaction within the country, which is fine because that is what a democratic process normally looks like. I think people from the older or the earlier dispensations and the who ascribed to the earlier more leftist or centrist ideologies are finding it difficult to accept the current ideology that people are accepting more and more. And therefore, there is some sort of disagreement between the two sides. Again, I think that is purely part of democracy. So, and with regard to our institutions or Supreme Court, you know, I beg to differ. My father was the man who introduced the bill for supersession of judges in Parliament about more than 40 years ago. He's been dead for 47 years now. So the question of how democratic, less or more democratic, is really a qualitative question. There will be people who will support the earlier times. There will be people who will say we are more democratic now. But to say that democracy is at risk in India is, I think, an insult to the smarts of our Indian people. Today, people know exactly what they want to vote for and what they vote for. And this is true of even the bigger states, whether it is UP or Bihar or West Bengal, where many of us may have our own problems with the current governments who are now there, who are in power. But it is, as I said before, this is the democratic system. If we find problems with the system, that's a different question. Again, we are free to try and change the system in what way we think we should. Everyone has an equal, I don't think that's perhaps not entirely true. Everyone has the equal right, yes. And those who want to make their voices heard have every opportunity to make it heard. So basically, we need reforms in the political process. We need more transparency there. We need far better education and health systems in place. Some states are doing fine. But to pin the whole blame of any one situation in any country on just one person or one ideology is not fair. All ideologies have got their own pros and cons, and everybody is free to either agree or disagree. So I think democracy is still doing fine in India. Perhaps everybody doesn't feel that way. But then that is the beauty of the democratic process, that each person has a right to their own opinion. Thank you.
Okay, we are coming to the end. So our democracy may or may not be robust or vibrant, but this webinar was certainly robust and vibrant. And I'll conclude just 1 minute by drawing a parallel to what happened during emergency, where I was very much in government service. I was in touch with a lot of things. And now a lot of talk going on that when there was an emergency imposed by Indira Gandhi, now there is unofficial emergency. This is very frequently, and people are writing in newspapers and articles also. But I have seen both. I have seen that from very close quarters. This also from very close quarters. Yes, there is a lot of justification in this kind of apprehension. But it is better for the government, for the leaders who are running the country, to remove this apprehension from the mind of the people. Democracy is our greatest asset. See, as said Jayaprakash Narayan, I don't want to quote him now, freedom. Without freedom, there is no democracy. And do we have freedom now? That's the question. So democracy is our biggest asset, not chapati, not rice, not any kind of security that we are talking about. Everything is only after democracy and freedom. I think with that spirit, thank you very much for participating in this webinar and contributing your excellent ideas. Thank you very much. And all those the audience who participated, thank you very much. Goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Namaskar. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.